Read the agreement in full. Hereth two leaders finally managed to agree sufficient progress had been made on talks, moving negotiations onto trade and treaties after months of stalling from the EU's chief negotiator Michel Barnier. The deal was preempted by signs of a breakthrough from Brussels, with Mr. Juncker's right-hand man Martin Selmayr posting a picture of white smoke on Twitter, an apparent reference to the manner in which the Vatican signals the choosing of a new pope. Meanwhile, Theresa May's top aide, Chief of Staff Gavin Barwell, remarked it had been a long week. But the Prime Minister warned in her speech there had been give and take on both sides in talks. Now, with the deal struck, how will Theresa May's Commons allies and enemies respond to the historic deal? Scroll down for all the latest updates as Brexit PROGRESSESGETTY Sky. Theresa May and Jean-Claude Juncker announced the deal would progress to Stage 2 Gibraltar, and the EU Gibraltar will not enjoy the benefit of a transition period, EU officials have said, with the rock dropping out of both the single market and the customs union when the UK leaves the bloc on March 29, 2019. Any arrangement over the future of Gibraltar needs to be struck between Spain and the UK. Previously, number 10 had said that any Brexit deal must work for Gibraltar, after Spanish government sources said the UK territory might be excluded from any transitional arrangement unless there is agreement over its future status. Prime Minister Theresa May and Jean-Claude Juncker have agreed terms on the first stage of Brexit. Countries around the world have given warnings to the EU regarding giving Britain a better trade deal than is currently in place with any of the EU's trading partners. A senior EU official is quoted by The Guardian as saying, "We cannot upset relations with other third countries. If we were to give the UK a very lopsided deal, then the other partners with whom we have been engaging and entered into balanced agreements would of course come back and question those agreements. Some of these agreements have specific most favoured nation clauses. If you give better to others, you will have to come back and give us the same. So also for this reason we need to maintain this balance of rights and obligations." AFP Theresa May greets Jean-Claude Juncker in Brussels. Nigel Farage on Sky News. Former UKIP leader Nigel Farage, asked by Sky News if he thought the deal was a victory for Theresa May, said, "It's a victory if you think paying away a gargantuan sum of money is a good thing, if you think giving foreign courts jurisdiction over this country for nearly up to a decade to come, and, in terms of alignment, well, really what we are saying today is that the potential benefits of Brexit won't be realized because we will not be able to put in place laws that suit our own industry." Get a former UKIP leader and MEP Nigel Farage. Mariano Rajoy tweets his congratulations to Theresa May and the head of the EU. Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy tweeted his congratulations to the EU heads over concluding the deal. Mr. Rajoy wrote, "The agreements reached between the European Union and the United Kingdom are good news and will minimize the costs of Brexit. I congratulate Michel Barnier and Theresa May for their efforts on everyone's behalf." EPA Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy. Liberal Democrat leader Vince Cable said that it was only a matter of time before the deal would be torn apart by Theresa May's own MPs. He said, "This agreement is welcome as it reduces the risk of a catastrophic no-deal Brexit. It also includes a role for the EU Court of Justice for 8 years, a notable concession, but how long will this deal last before it is torn apart by Theresa May's own MPs? And what will happen next, seeing as the cabinet hasn't even discussed yet what the final Brexit outcome should look like? There are still two opposing views in government, those who want a close arrangement with the EU and those who want to tear apart decades of work building ties with our closest trading partner. And there is still no solution over how to prevent a border between Ireland and Northern Ireland. The biggest obstacle to the government's Brexit plans is being kicked into the long grass. The government is still a long way from a final deal, and even further from delivering on what the Brexiters promised. At the end of this process, it is the British people, not Tory MPs and the DUP, who should get to decide whether the deal is good enough." Getty Liberal Democrat leader Vince Cable 2.05. Guy Verhofstadt lays down his red lines for Phase 2. Guy Verhofstadt, the European Parliament's Brexit figurehead, has laid down his red lines on Brexit just hours after an initial deal has been struck. He confirmed the European Parliament's recommendation is to confirm sufficient progress had been made. However, he outlined key issues he wanted to see tackled. They included the rights of citizens to bring future partners into the country and guarantees for UK citizens living on the continent. He added that he wanted to see the development of an ombudsman who would be able to take the concerns of EU citizens for court. 2 PM Jeremy Corbyn finally speaks out on deal in a speech to the UN. Jeremy Corbyn has laid out his vision for Brexit following ever-changing party policy on how the UK will thrive outside of the EU. He said he would oppose those who want to use Brexit to turn Britain in on itself, or to put rocket boosters under our current economic systems, insecurities and inequalities, adding his party stands for a completely different future when we leave the EU, drawing on the best internationalist traditions of the labor movement and our country. It is unclear if Mr. Corbyn would have spoken on Brexit today if it had not been for the morning's developments. He had been scheduled to speak at the UN summit on human rights before the deal was struck. He went on to tweet 18 months on from the referendum, Theresa May has scraped through phase one. Tory chaos and posturing has caused damaging delay and risked serious harm to our economy. We need a much stronger and more constructive approach in crucial phase two. 1:55 p.m. Britain could be free to strike trade deals around the world before Brexitocrats have revealed they may open the door for Britain to negotiate trade deals around the world during a transition period and a big boost for Theresa May. EU officials said member states have not ruled out giving their consent for the UK to actively seek free trade agreements across the globe even whilst still in the single market and customs union. The remarks will be seen as a significant olive branch to Downing Street, which has always maintained Britain must be able to plan for its future whilst decoupling itself from the bloc. Diplomats also said that member states are now likely to get more closely involved in talks on a second phase of negotiations on trade, having taken a hands-off approach to the technical divorce issues. Twitter: Boris Johnson met with the Prime Minister in an oddly publicised move. 1:40 p.m. We wish you a merry Brexit. Theresa May struck one of the most pivotal deals in the nation's history as a Christmas party raged around her. Insiders have confirmed the Prime Minister spent much of the night locked in a phone conversation with Dup leader Arlene Foster to ease concerns over the Irish border. Meanwhile, the Downing Street Christmas party got underway, with one aide saying celebrations were going on around the Prime Minister during the auspicious evening. Her spokesman said, "It was a long night, the text kept changing until it was in a place where everybody felt it was what we needed to achieve." But despite the Prime Minister's home being taken over by festivities, her focus remained on securing a deal. A spokesman said, "The Prime Minister had a tough day yesterday. There was a lot of work to be done, a lot of conversations to be had. We are pleased we've got to the place we are this morning." 1:30 p.m. Nicola Sturgeon blasts £50 billion payment for lesser trade deal. Nicola Sturgeon has doubled down on her call for special arrangements for Scotland after the second phase of negotiations. She went on to hit out at the government for paying £50 billion just for the right to negotiate an inferior trade deal than the one we have now. She said, "I am absolutely clear that any special arrangements for Northern Ireland must now be available to other nations of the UK. The Scottish government will not accept any arrangements which risk putting Scotland at an economic disadvantage. Short of continuing EU membership, the best outcome for jobs and living standards is to retain membership of the single market and customs union, both in transition and permanently. We will continue to argue that case, including at the next meeting of the Joint Ministerial Committee in London next week. We will be studying the details of the Phase 1 agreement, but we welcome the fact that finally there has been some movement to guarantee the rights of EU and UK citizens, although it is disgraceful that it has taken this long and there is still more to do in Phase 2. In addition, it seems the UK could also now be paying around £50 billion just for the right to negotiate an inferior trade deal than the one we have now." Friday, December 8, 2017, David Davis and EU's chief Brexit negotiator Michel Barnier attend a press conference by Theresa May. 1:25 p.m. European media responds to EU deal across the continent. Media outlets have had mixed responses to Brexit negotiations, and Mrs. May. France's Le Monde writes about Theresa May's extensive concessions, saying, "The relief was such in London that the most Europhobic members of the May government seem to be in unison with a praise concert addressed to the Prime Minister." The Frankfurter Allgemeine says there are mixed feelings on the island, despite the breakthrough being well received across much of Europe, adding it was a matter for the PM of her political survival. Italy's Repubblica reports on former politician Dario Franceschini, who claims the UK has chosen a soft exit. 1 p.m. Julian Smith whips up publicity for May Johnson meeting. The chief whip has shared a picture of Boris Johnson meeting with Theresa May last night in an unusually publicized move. Sharing the image, which Mr. Smith described as a nice moment, is an unorthodox decision given the government does not often make a point of announcing casual meetings between ministers. However, the public nature of the meeting could be a means of persuading Brexiteers that one of the top symbols of the movement to leave has sided with the Prime Minister's deal. 12:35 p.m. Downing Street confirm. Brexit bill payment number 10 have confirmed the UK expects to pay between £3,539 billion as a divorce settlement to the EU. A spokesman said, "We see this as a fair settlement of our obligations. We've always been clear that where we had obligation, we would honour them. It's been a forensic process. Teams from the department from exiting the European Union went through this line by line, but we think we've reached a fair agreement. He went on to defend the decision to have the ECJ hold jurisdiction over the UK. The spokesman added, in terms of the ECJ European Court of Justice, we think we are looking at around 2 to 3 cases a year in relation to citizens' rights only, and most importantly, it would be a decision taken by a British court whether or not they wanted to refer a case to the ECJ for review. That would be an entirely voluntary process. It will be the UK courts who are taking the decisions on UK citizens in Europe moving to other European countries. That is a matter that has not been settled yet. 12:15 PM, Sadiq Khan forges ahead with his own plans for Brexit in London. Sadiq Khan will launch his own Brexit impact assessments for London after David Davis admitted he had not carried out any sectoral analyses. Mr. Khan announced the move just hours after Theresa May struck her deal to move Brexit talks into phase two. It comes after he claimed London should have its own Brexit deal if concessions were made to keep Northern Ireland tied to the EU. He said, "It is outrageous that the government either failed to properly consider the impact of Brexit on Britain's economy, or are refusing to release their analysis. If it's the former, then I question their competence. If it is the latter, then I question whether they have something to hide. We need to know the impact of different Brexit scenarios on our economy in order to deliver a Brexit deal that protects jobs and growth." 11:50 AM, we can still have a hard Brexit. John Redwood claims concerns have been raised over the wording of the agreement, which ensures the UK will remain in key EU institutions if talks break down. But Brexiteer John Redwood has maintained the UK is still in a strong position if we decide to walk away from the negotiations. In a lengthy statement, Mr. Redwood kept the dreams of a hard Brexit alive. He wrote, "Today we learned that the EU is now prepared to talk about trade and the future relationship, as well as the three special subjects it singled out for discussion so far. That is welcome, and means there can now be serious negotiations about a future agreement. Everyone needs to remember that today's agreement is not the agreement on the UK leaving the EU. It is an agreement to talk about all matters, and is still governed by the crucial principle that nothing is agreed until everything is agreed. We need to remember that leaving on the WTO option means no additional payments to the EU, whilst taking back control of our borders, our laws, our money. A good deal has to be better than this, otherwise the government's mantra that no deal is better than a bad deal should apply." Sky Michael Gove has claimed UK courts will be firmly in the driving seat after Brexit. 11:40 AM, Nigel Farage claims Britain did not vote for this deal. Nigel Farage has heaped even more scorn on Theresa May's deal, saying it betrays the vote of the nation. Hitting out at Boris Johnson for backing the Phase 1 agreement, he said, "Well done, Boris. Party first. Always put party loyalty first. A cabinet of 25 people, 18 of who are Remainers, and it's all about the party, not about the country and not about what we voted for. 17.4 million people did not vote for a large exit fee, did not vote for the European Court of Justice to go on having a say over this country, and most certainly did not vote, and this is the next thing coming up, for a transition deal that will probably last until the next general election. So the worry, with everything that has happened today, is that whilst we will leave the European Union, it may well be we do it in name only." 11:30 AM, Britain will remain in customs union and single market after Brexit. Leaked EU paper confirms a leaked draft paper outlining the EU's position on phase two of negotiations has claimed the UK will have to obey EU rules and remain in the customs union and single market during the transition phase of Brexit. It adds the UK will not be able to elect any decision-makers to influence the 27-nation superstate, confirming recommendations put out by EC President Donald Tusk earlier today. The draft paper, which has been delivered to capitals across the EU, says existing union regulatory, budgetary, supervisory, judiciary and enforcement instruments and structures will also apply, as the United Kingdom will remain a member of the customs union and the single market with all four freedoms during the transition. It will have to continue to apply and collect EU customs tariffs and ensure all EU checks are being performed on the border vis-à-vis other third countries. Michel Barnier confirmed the UK will continue to pay into the EU budget. 11 AM, UK banking stocks boost after Brexit deal. Secured stocks in the UK's banks have experienced a significant boost amid confidence over the UK's future. Shares in Barclays, Lloyds Banking Group and Royal Bank of Scotland Group rose 3%, 4.1% and 1.7% respectively, while overall, the stocks Europe 600 rose 0.9% in the morning thanks to a 2.8% rise in the banking sector. Speaking to the Wall Street Journal, J.P. Morgan chief European strategist Karen Ward said, talks are proceeding amicably, they are constructive, and if we can agree near term on a transition deal, it alleviates uncertainty for both sides of the channel. 10:40 a.m. Brexit bill. Britain will pay between £35 £39 billion. UK's final divorce bill has been estimated at between £3,539 billion, sources confirmed to Express.co, UK's Brussels correspondent today. The payment will break down into three separate categories covering the rest of the EU's current budgetary period, future commitments and liabilities such as pensions. EU chief negotiator Michel Barnier today refused to put an official figure on the amount, saying it is not possible to do so. However, it is understood that a calculation has been made and that the maximum amount Britain can expect to pay is £39 billion. 10:30 a.m. Scottish squabbles. Ruth Davidson hits out at Nicola Sturgeon's independence lunger. Ruth Davidson has launched a blistering attack on Nicola Sturgeon, accusing her of using Brexit to bang on the drum of Scottish independence. The Scottish Tory leader told Ms. Sturgeon to give it a rest after the SNP leader called for the UK to remain tied to the EU by being part of the single market and customs union, saying it was the only sensible option when quizzed over what she would do differently. On Twitter, the Scottish First Minister simply replied, not leave the EU. 10:20 a.m. I've done all I can. Tory chief whip says he attempted to represent wide range of views in party. Tory chief whip Julian Smith has claimed the agreement represents the wide range of views in the party. Many, such as rising star Jacob Rees-Mogg and Peter Bone, have long called for a hard break from Brussels. Meanwhile, others like Europhiles Ken Clark and Anas O'Bree have attempted to soften Brexit. Mr. Smith said, I have done everything I can to represent the wide range of views of Conservatives colleagues as Chief Whip. I will continue to do everything I can to ensure that the views of Conservatives MPs are well reflected in Phase 2. He added, I have been privileged to work with the DUP all week to ensure that Northern Ireland will never be separated from the UK as we leave the EU. 10:10 a.m. Michael Gove, Britain will now be in charge. Michael Gove has said that while the ECJ will control to rule over Britain for years after Brexit, it will be UK courts that are firmly in the driving seat. The agreement between Mrs. May and Mr. Junca enshrines that the European Courts of Justice will have a say in UK affairs for at least 8 years following Brexit. But the staunch Brexiteer defended the concession, arguing it will only apply in very specific circumstances. Mr. Gove said this agreement is a significant political achievement for the Prime Minister and it helps guarantee the rights of EU citizens in the UK, and it will be UK courts that safeguard those rights. Of course they will have regard to EU law, and in a limited number of cases, for a limited period of time, they can, if they wish to, if there is a point of law that is ambiguous, go to the European Court of Justice for help in resolving the issue. But it is important to recognize this as a time-limited and very specific exemption and it is UK courts in the driving seat. 10 a.m. Sadiq Khan accuses PM of U-turn on citizens' rights. Sadiq Khan, who has repeatedly hit out at Brexit after the majority of London voted to remain, has claimed Theresa May has U-turned on citizens' rights. In a statement, the Mayor of London said the government need to now accelerate progress. We simply cannot afford further delays. It is clear from the many conversations I have with business leaders that they need to know the details of the interim deal as early as possible in order to avoid having to put contingency plans into place. I welcome the apparent U-turn from Theresa May on the rights of EU citizens living in the UK, and British citizens living in the EU. I will pore over the details of this over the coming days because there needs to be clear and unambiguous reassurance to the 3 million EU citizens in Britain, 1 million of whom are Londoners, that they can stay, and that they'll have automatic rights. 9:50 a.m. Boris Johnson falls in line behind PM. Now let's get on with it. Boris Johnson has fallen in line behind the Prime Minister, saying now is the time to strike forward and ensure the nation takes back control from Brussels. He said, congratulations to PM for her determination in getting today's deal. We now aim to forge a deep and special partnership with our European friends and allies while remaining true to the referendum result, taking back control of our laws, money and borders for the whole of the UK. Reuters' Deetasia said he had got everything he set out to achieve. 9:30 a.m. UKIP leader blasts May's deal. UKIP leader Henry Bolton has slammed Theresa May's deal, describing her concessions as shocking. Commenting on the deal, he said Mrs. May is giving away our independence. In the absence of agreed solutions, the United Kingdom will maintain full alignment with those rules of the internal market and the customs union. Shocking. 9:10 a.m. Barnier, Britain will pay Brexit divorce bill. EU negotiator Michel Barnier has confirmed the UK will pay out billions to leave the 27-nation superstate. the nation will continue to pay into the union as though it were a member despite getting nothing back from the bloc. He said no member state will pay more or receive less because of Brexit. As Theresa May said in her speech in Florence, "We have confirmed that the UK will honour all of the commitments entered into during its membership." Theresa May said that too in her speech in Florence, and we make that clear. As regards its obligations, the UK will pay no more, nor earlier, than if it was a member state. However, he admitted he had been swayed by the UK negotiating team. Mr. Barnier added, "There are points where I've got closer to the UK position, yes, on the financial settlement, for example." 9:05 a.m. Michel Barnier outlines Brexit deal. The EU's chief negotiator Michel Barnier has said the deal is precise and detailed, but there is still work to be done. He also hit back at comments made by David Davis earlier this year, creative and flexible, calling on his counterparts to offer a sense of responsibility. 9 a.m. Labour's Brexit shadow secretary gives deal his blessing but accuses May of chaos. Keir Starmer has thrown his support behind Theresa May's deal, while accusing her of presiding over a year of chaos. In a statement he said, "Despite being 2 months later than originally planned, it is encouraging that the European Commission has recommended sufficient progress in the Brexit negotiations. The priority for both sides now must be to agree transitional arrangements on the same basic terms as we have now. That means staying in the single market and a customs union for a time-limited period. We will also need to know the political price of the deal struck and the impact any compromise that has been agreed will have on our future relationship with the EU." As the talks now move on to a discussion about Britain's future relationship with the European Union, Theresa May must seriously reflect on her approach to the negotiations so far. "We cannot have another year of chaos and confusion or the farcical scenes we saw earlier on in the week that put jobs and the economy at risk." 8:45 Another Brexit basher backs May's deal. Anna Sobry hails progress. Anna Sobry, who once claimed history, will condemn those who haven't stood up and tried to stop all this nonsense, has expressed her joy at Theresa May's deal. She wrote, "This morning's Phase 1 agreement gets a warm welcome from me. PM is representing UK business needs healing dreadful Brexit divide." 8:35 a.m. Tusk, "The most difficult challenge is yet to begin." Donald Tusk has said the most arduous elements of Brexit are yet to begin, with just a year left for negotiations. He wrote, "I've sent Brexit guidelines for the second phase to EU27 leaders. While being satisfied with today's agreement, let's remember that the most difficult challenge still ahead. Breaking up is hard, but breaking up and building a new relationship is much harder." Getty. Donald Tusk demanded Britain will obey the laws of Brussels, even after Brexit. 8:30 a.m. She has repainted her red lines. Good news for Brexit basher Chuka Yumuna. Chuka Yumuna, who has regularly hit out at the nation's decision to leave, has said it's about time Brexit progressed. Speaking on Radio 4's Today programme, he added, "It has been 18 months since the referendum and only now have we agreed to start talks about our future relationship with our largest trading partner. It is very welcome, but we really need to get on with this." This has entailed the Prime Minister having to radically repaint her red lines. It follows comments from Brexiteer Jacob Rees-Mogg, who claimed in PMQs on Wednesday Mrs. May's lines were looking a little pink and needed a new coat of paint. 8:25 a.m. Leo Varadkar, "Northern Irish citizens can still be EU citizens." Irish Taoiseach Leo Varadkar has confirmed Northern Irish citizens will have access to EU citizen rights if they chose to exercise their right to be an Irish citizen. Those rights will include freedom to move through the bloc and settle in any EU member state. Speaking just over an hour after the agreement was struck, Mr. Varadkar told Irish citizens, "We have achieved all that we set out to achieve." He added, "This is not the end, but it is the end of the beginning, and we will remain engaged and vigilant throughout Phase 2. The EU document confirms deal for Northern Ireland. The UK will maintain alignment with those rules of the internal market and the customs union which, now or in the future, support North-South cooperation, the all-island economy and the protection of the 1998 agreement." 8:15 a.m. No ECJ. Theresa May's promises clash with Donald Tusk's demands. Theresa May assured Britons in a speech outlining her commitments to Northern Ireland that the whole of the United Kingdom, including Northern Ireland, will no longer be subject to the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice. However, in his comments, Donald Tusk demanded that during this transition period the UK will respect the whole of EU law, including new law. While it is possible Mr. Tusk is only referring to laws enshrined by the Brussels bureaucracy and not the rulings of the ECJ, Mrs. May could be referring to the establishment of a new body to sideline the role of the European Courts of Justice. On Monday, the European Union reportedly conceded on the jurisdiction of the European Courts of Justice, with sources claiming instead a new system will be set up to process complaints from EU citizens in the UK, 8:05 a.m. No borders. Theresa May's reassurances to Northern Ireland reveal Theresa May was forced to come up with clear commitments to Northern Ireland to ensure her Commons allies the DUP would back a deal. And in response to Monday's breakdown, Mrs. May has spoken out to reassure Britons no new borders are put in place across the UK or Ireland. Her draft list of unshakable promises to Northern Ireland is follows: an assurance to uphold and support Northern Ireland's status as an integral part of the United Kingdom, an assurance to protect and maintain Northern Ireland's position within the single market of the United Kingdom, an assurance the government will not create new borders within the UK or a hard border across the island of Ireland, a confirmation the whole of the United Kingdom, including Northern Ireland, will leave the EU customs union and the EU single market, a promise to uphold commitments and safeguards set out in the Good Friday Agreement, a confirmation no part of the UK, including Northern Ireland, will remain subject to the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice. Twitter: Nigel Farage offered a bittersweet comment on the negotiations. 8 a.m. Nigel Farage hits out at Brexit humiliation. Nigel Farage has said it is good Theresa May could move talks forward, as the nation could now progress into the next phase of humiliation. He tweeted, "A deal in Brussels is good news for Mrs. May, as we can now move on to the next stage of humiliation." He later told The Telegraph, "The European Court of Justice will be the ultimate arbiter of EU citizens' rights. This is not acceptable." Earlier this week, the Brexit figurehead, a deal conceding Northern Ireland would remain in the customs union and the single market was a betrayal and would damage the integrity of the UK. He also implied the deal could rouse nationalist sentiments in Scotland. He said, "This is a bitter betrayal of 17.4 million people. It is a concession too far, for it will lead to endless problems in Scotland and it damages the integrity of the United Kingdom." 7:50 a.m. David Davis: "It's time to move forward." David Davis has heralded the step forward in negotiations, as well as agreements on citizens' rights. Mr. Davis wrote, "Citizens can now be confident about the rights they enjoy. We should now move forward to discuss our future relationship with the EU on issues like trade and security." 7:35 a.m. Tusk: "Britain will obey our rules." European Council President Donald Tusk has demanded the UK obey EU rules during the transition period, including new edicts handed down by Brussels. Speaking with a grave tone from Brussels, Mr. Tusk said, "This morning I received the confirmation from our negotiators that sufficient progress had been made. We should start negotiating the transition deal so people and business have clarity about the situation. The UK has asked for a transition deal of about 2 years. However," he added, "we have our conditions. I propose that during this period the UK will respect the whole of EU law, including new law, it will respect budgetary commitments, it will respect judicial oversight, and of course all other commitments." Yesterday it was revealed a European Parliament draft proposal would allow the EU to tell Britain what to do during any post-Brexit transition period. Theresa May set out a transition period of 2 years following Brexit in her Florence speech, in which she laid out her red lines for Brexit. Chancellor Philip Hammond had previously pushed for a lengthy transition of up to 3 years, while hard-line Brexiteers including Tory MP Owen Paterson described putting off the nation's EU evacuation as absolute toshgetta. Theresa May confirmed significant give-and-take had been part of the deal. 7:30 a.m. "Nothing agreed until everything is agreed." The deal struck by Theresa May and Jean-Claude Juncker outlines Britain still has the right to walk away from a bad deal. It notes the terms between the EU and Britain are agreed by UK on condition of an overall agreement under Article 50 on UK's withdrawal, taking into account framework for the future relationship, including an agreement as early as possible in 2018 on transitional arrangements. The clause will reassure Brexiteers including John Redwood, who told express.co.uk at the start of the week he was glad the government's policy is nothing is agreed until all is agreed, and that no deal is better than a bad deal. Get high. Theresa May's team had been negotiating long into the night ahead of the deal. 7 a.m. deal done. Theresa May and Jean-Claude Juncker move talks on following an all-night negotiation between Belfast, Brussels, Dublin and London. The Prime Minister has announced Brexit will progress before the new year. The text of an agreement between the EU and the UK, which will be signed off by EU 27 leaders next week, is expected to be published later today, Mr. Juncker said. "Prime Minister May has assured me that it has the backing of the UK government. The Commission has just formally decided to recommend to the European Council that sufficient progress has been made on the terms of the divorce. Today's result is of course the compromise, as in any negotiation both sides had to listen to each other, adjust their position and show a willingness to compromise. It is a result of a long and tense discussion between the Commission negotiators and those of the UK. Mrs. May said the new text represents a significant improvement on the draft rejected by the DUP on Monday. She said, "I hope and expect we will be able to get the endorsement of the 27 to what is a hard-won agreement in all of our interests. I believe it's a matter of trust and integrity in politicians for people to be able to trust that their politicians will put into place what they have determined, and that's exactly what we're doing, and we will be leaving the European Union."